responsibly Psalm 71. The first 12 verses, I will read verse 1, you respond with verse 2, and so on and so forth. The church, in its wisdom, decided not to number the pages like in the Green Book. So I'll give you a moment. In you, O Lord, have I taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame.
In your righteousness, deliver me and set me free. Incline your ear to me and save me.
Be my strong rock, a castle to keep me safe. You are my crag and my stronghold.
Deliver me, my God, from the hands of the wicked, from the clutches of the evildoer and the oppressor.
For you are my hope, O Lord God, my confidence, since I was young.
I have been sustained by you ever since I was born. From my mother's womb, you have been my strength. My prayer shall always be of you.
I have become a portent to many, but you are my refuge and my strength.
Let my mouth be full of your praise and your glory all day long.
Do not cast me off in my old age. Forsake me not when my strength fails.
For my enemies are talking against me, and those who lie in wait for my life take counsel together.
They say, pursue and seize that one whom God has forsaken, because there is none who will save.
O God, be not far from me. Come quickly to help me, O my God.
Please be seated. Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah, the 49th chapter. Listen to me, O coastlands. Pay attention, you peoples from far away. The Lord called me before I was born. While I was in my mother's womb, he named me. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He had me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver, he hid me away. And he said to me, you are my servant, Israel, in whom I will be glorified. But I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity. Yet surely my cause is with the Lord, and my reward with my God. And now the Lord says, who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, and that Israel might be gathered to him, for I am honored in the sight of the Lord, and my God has become my strength. He says, it is too light a thing that you should be my servant, to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel. I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Here ends the reading.
Was lost, but now I'm found.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 18th chapter. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" And they answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves, judge him according to your own law." And the Jews replied, "We're not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus answered, "Do you ask this of your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked, "So, you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him. But you have a custom that I release someone to you at the Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" And they shouted and replied, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. And they kept coming up to him saying, "Hail, king of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I'm bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." And when the chief priests and the police saw it, they shouted, "Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." Then the Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he claimed to be the Son of God." Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. And he entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and the power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat down on the judge's bench in a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now, it was the day of preparation for the Passover. It was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." And they cried out, "Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" And the chief priest answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified.
There stood Jesus, beaten, bloody, and alone. Into the courtyard strode Herod, accompanied by his bodyguards. He had wanted to see this man ever since he had heard about him. This man had fascinated him, just like John the Baptist had fascinated him. Maybe there was a little fear mixed into the fascination, but now he had the opportunity to see this man perform some miracle. "So, you are the man that can turn water into wine," said Herod. But Jesus spoke not a word. "Well, are you a king?" asked Herod. And again, Jesus spoke not a word. "If you are a king, where is your army and where is your kingdom?" asked Herod, more upset this time. Again, Jesus spoke not a word. The chief priests and scribes were getting impatient. Herod was wasting time with this nobody. "He said we shouldn't pay taxes to Caesar," they shouted. "Did you say that?" asked Herod. But Jesus stood silent. "He said he could destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. That definitely would start a revolution," yelled the priest. "You can do such a miracle?" said Herod to Jesus. But Jesus stood silent. "If you are a king, then here, wear this robe," said Herod, as he laughingly put the robe on the shoulders of Jesus. The soldiers also laughed and sneered. "The king of the Jews," they mocked and pretended to bow before him. Still Jesus stood silent. I watched this drama unfold from the security of a pillar in the courtyard. I wondered why this Galilean rabbi would not answer Herod. What could his silence achieve? Something inside of me told me that this man was heading to a Roman cross. Why would he not do everything possible to try to persuade Herod that he did not deserve to die? Silence can be a powerful tool. It makes the one who is speaking look deeply into their own hearts and minds, to examine their own feelings and responses. When we ask a question or make an inquiry, we expect a certain answer. When we do not get any response, then we begin to question ourselves. Is this what this rabbi was doing? I kept my distance, but I wanted to shout and stand in front of this rabbi and tell Herod about all the wonderful miracles I had seen and all the wonderful things that this rabbi had taught me, but I kept silent. Had God forsaken this prophet? I wondered. I had seen Jesus when he met Peter in the courtyard, and Peter had denied him. Again, Jesus was silent. Can you imagine that one of his closest followers would not even claim that he knew him? After all that we have seen, we were afraid. That must be it. It was fear. The silence of Jesus became a deafening roar in my ears. His silence became an accusation. Was he trying to tell Herod that he was not to be treated like a court jester or a magician that performed on command? Herod was not interested in learning about the kingdom of God. He only wanted someone to entertain him. He wanted someone who could tell him the future or help him win some victory with magic. Why had I followed this rabbi? The silence of Jesus made me examine my motives. Was I any better than Herod? Of course I was. I wasn't a butcher. I did not live the life that Herod lived. I had not murdered one of the prophets. Yet here I stood, hidden behind the pillar, watching this innocent rabbi who was headed for a Roman cross, and I said nothing. I did nothing to stop. I was a murderer just as surely as if I was the one who drove the nails into his hands and feet. The silence of Jesus closed around me, and my heart began to break. Was it not this rabbi who had given me hope when the priests and scribes not only looked at me with contempt? He was the one who taught me that God loved and accepted me. All my life I had tried to keep the law, but I couldn't. It was impossible. The Pharisees and priests told me about a God that demanded the impossible and then punished me when I could not achieve it. Then that day on the mountain, I heard Jesus. His words were about a God that accepted me and loved me. I still remember his words. His words are blessings for me. Those words changed my life. Those words changed me forever. But have I really changed? The man responsible for that change is only a few feet from me, and yet I keep silent. And in that silence, I stand condemned before God. I turned around, ready to leave this place, ready to go back to the life that I lived before I met this man. And then, as Jesus was being brought out to the crowd, he turned and looked directly at me. It was as if he knew, really knew, that I was there. I saw the sorrow in his eyes, but I also saw something else. It was peace, true shalom, the peace that passes all human understanding. Why would he be at peace? Did he not know that he was heading for a Roman cross? With a compassionate tone in his voice, he spoke to me, to my doubts and to my questions. His words rang loudly in my ears, but I was the only one who could hear them. My child, I do this for you, so that you may know of the love that the Father has for you. My journey will be a journey of pain and agony, but I am willingly take this journey so that you may have a relationship with my Father in heaven. You are my child. For this I was born, and for this I will die. I will not leave you desolate. I will be with you forever. Do not grieve. Rejoice in your Father's love. And then my Savior was led away to die for me. What wondrous love is this? God loves me so much that he willingly sent his own Son to the cross so that my relationship with him will be everlasting. I bowed my head in humbleness and awe. I left that courtyard renewed. I was a new person, a person God Almighty valued. That thought went spinning through my body and touched each part of my heart. It was like I had been reborn. Reborn because my guilt, my sins, my anguish had been laid on this man's shoulders. God did this for me. Amen.
Let us stand for prayer. Loving and sacrificing God, as we humble ourselves before the cross, grant us your love and your forgiveness. Help us to listen for your voice that calls us to love without the restraint of fear. May our love be a full and complete reflection of the sacrificial love of Christ. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen.